The production of this video was made possible by donors to the Orchestration Online Patreon initiative. Please consider adding your support to the creation of free educational internet resources by visiting our Patreon page linked below. Hey there, this is your orchestration tutor, Thomas Goss, with a special holiday lecture and score analysis in our ongoing series on Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. First, I'll give you a quick roundup of books by and about Stravinsky, especially those that focus on our main topic. Then I'll finish with a complete analysis of the introduction to Part 2, The Sacrifice, open to all viewers here on YouTube. Last month, we saw that there were countless videos about Stravinsky and the Rite of Spring posted on YouTube. This simply mirrors a wealth of writings about the 20th century's most famous composer and his greatest work. Additionally, there are important insights about the Rite in many books that deal with music in a more general way, not to mention scholarly papers, articles in journals and newspapers, and so on. There's no way I could cover them all without completely exhausting myself and boring you, so I'll just mention a shorter list of those that I feel are worth reading, and you can take it from there. A great place to start is with Stravinsky's 1936 autobiography, which seems to have passed into the public domain, so that anyone can read it here on the internet. I've linked a copy on archive.org, which is probably the easiest format to read on screen. It's an extremely brief account, covering the complex life of the composer up to age 54 in a mere 200 pages. The writing style is breezy and engaging, with wonderfully drawn character sketches of the most important people with whom he worked. Here I must say more of Diaghilev, because the close association I had with him during this first collaboration revealed the very essence of his great personality. What struck me most was the degree of endurance and tenacity that he displayed in pursuit of his ends. His strength in this direction was so exceptional that it was always somewhat terrifying, though at the same time reassuring, to work with him. It was terrifying because whenever there was a divergence of opinion, it was arduous and exhausting to struggle with him. But it was reassuring to know that the goal was certain to be reached once our differences had been overcome. The quality of his intelligence and mentality also attracted me. He had a wonderful flair, a marvelous faculty for seizing at a glance the novelty and freshness of an idea, surrendering himself to it without pausing to reason it out. I do not mean to imply that he was at all lacking in reasoning power. On the contrary, his reasoning powers were unerring, and he had a most rational mind, and, though he frequently made mistakes or acted foolishly, it was because he had been carried away by passion or temperament, the two forces predominant in him. He had at the same time a broad and generous nature, usually incapable of calculation, and, when he did calculate, it meant only that he himself was penniless. On the other hand, when he was in funds, he spent lavishly on himself and on others. An odd trait in his character was his strange indifference toward the somewhat dubious honesty of some of those who were in touch with him, and even when they victimized him, as long as their dishonesty was offset by other qualities. What he most detested were the commonplace, incapacity, a lack of savoir-faire. He hated and despised a fool. Strangely enough, in this highly intelligent man, efficiency and shrewdness were accompanied by a certain childish ingenuousness. He never bore a grudge. When anyone swindled him, he was not angry, but would remark simply, "Well, what of it? He's looking after himself." What's just as interesting as what Stravinsky writes is what he chooses to leave out. There's little to no insight on his sources of inspiration or methods of musical composition, and certain key friends and acquaintances are almost completely erased from the record, such as Ravel's best friend and student, Maurice Delage, with whom Stravinsky had a close relationship and even relied on for housing while visiting Paris. His rewriting of history is almost always in a way that either makes himself look good or look like the victim of circumstance, and his treatment of Nijinsky is abominable, for all his later claims of respect. Nearly everything he says about Nijinsky's work as a choreographer is wrong. Diaghilev did not push Nijinsky into the role. The setting of Afternoon of a Faun was originally a secret known only to Nijinsky and his sister, and was Nijinsky's own idea from the start. The noteworthiness of the subsequent performance was not due solely to an erotic gesture at the end. As to the collaboration with Nijinsky for The Rite of Spring, Stravinsky is dripping with contempt and thinly disguised rage.
To be perfectly frank, I must say here and now that the idea of working with Nijinsky filled me with misgiving, notwithstanding our friendliness and my great admiration for his talent as a dancer and mime. His ignorance of the most elementary notions of music was flagrant. The poor boy knew nothing of music. He could neither read it nor play any instrument, and his reactions to music were expressed in banal phrases or the repetition of what he had heard others say. As one was unable to discover any individual impressions, one began to doubt whether he had any. These lacunae were so serious that his plastic vision, often of great beauty, could not compensate for them. My apprehensions can be readily understood, but I had no choice in the matter. Fokine had dissociated himself from Diaghilev, and in any case, considering his aesthetic tendencies, he would probably have refused to work at the Rite of Spring. Romanov was busy with Florent Schmidt's Salome. Only Nijinsky remained, and Diaghilev, still hopeful of making a ballet master of him, insisted that he should put on both the Rite and Debussy's Jeu. Nijinsky began by demanding such a fantastic number of rehearsals that it was physically impossible to give to him. It will not be difficult to understand why he wanted so many when I say that in trying to explain to him the construction of my work in general outline and in detail, I discovered that I should achieve nothing until I had taught him the very rudiments of music, values, semibrev, minim, crotchet, quaver, etc., bars, rhythm, tempo, and so on. He had the greatest difficulty in remembering any of this. Nor was that all. When, in listening to music, he contemplated movements, it was always necessary to remind him that he must make them accord with the tempo, its divisions and values. It was exasperating, and we advanced at a snail's pace. It was all the more trying because Nijinsky complicated and encumbered his dances beyond all reason, thus creating difficulties for the dancers that were sometimes impossible to overcome. This was due as much to his lack of experience as to the complexity of a task with which he was unfamiliar. Under these conditions, I did not want to leave him to his own devices, partly because of my kindly feeling for him, but partly on account of my work and considerations as to its fate. I therefore traveled a great deal so as to attend the rehearsals of the company, which, throughout that winter, took place in the different towns in which Diaghilev was giving performances. The atmosphere was always heavy and stormy. It was evident that the poor boy had been saddled with a task beyond his capacity. He appeared to be quite unconscious both of his inadequacy and of the fact that he had been given a role which, to put it shortly, he was incapable of filling in so serious an undertaking as the Russian ballet. Seeing that he was losing prestige with the company but was strongly upheld by Diaghilev, he became presumptuous, capricious, and unmanageable. The natural result was a series of painful incidents which seriously complicated matters. It should not be necessary for me to emphasize that in writing all this I have not the least desire to cast any slur on the fame of this magnificent artist. We were, as I have already said, always on the best of terms, and I have never ceased to admire his great talent for dancing and mime. He will always live in my memory, and I hope in the memory of everyone who had the good fortune to see him dance, as one of the most beautiful visions that ever appeared on the stage.
As if Nijinsky's reputation would have survived that kind of beating after Stravinsky got through with him. Actually, gossip about Nijinsky had already been the stock in trade of scandalmongers for decades, and Nijinsky had become incurably insane long ago, so this was just Stravinsky adding his lumps a whole generation after the fact. There's no question that Nijinsky was out of his depth, and I'll cover the process of how the Rite of Spring came to the stage in a later lecture called Prelude to a Riot. But there's more going on here than meets the eye. For now, though, I'll simply say that while this book is very readable and entertaining, it's not a reliable account of everything that happened at the height of Stravinsky's fame. The autobiography captures the perspective and notions of Stravinsky 23 years past the premiere of The Rite of Spring. His work with Robert Kraft is equally entertaining and far more extensive, and twice that distance from the premiere. Yet his memory, albeit selective, still seems very clear. I was sitting in the fourth or fifth row on the right, and the image of Monteux's back is more vivid in my mind today than the picture of the stage. He stood there apparently impervious and as nerveless as a crocodile. It is still almost incredible to me that he actually brought the orchestra through to the end. I left my seat when the heavy noises began, light noises had started from the very beginning, and went backstage behind Nijinsky in the right wing. Nijinsky stood on a chair just out of view of the audience, shouting numbers to the dancers. I wondered what on earth these numbers had to do with the music, for there are no 13s and 17s in the metrical scheme of the score. From what I heard of the musical performance, it was not bad. 16 full rehearsals had given the orchestra at least some security. After the performance, we were excited, angry, disgusted, and happy. I went with Diaghilev and Nijinsky to a restaurant. So far from weeping and reciting Pushkin in the Bois de Boulogne, as the legend is, Diaghilev's only comment was, "Exactly what I wanted." He certainly looked contented. No one could have been quicker to understand the publicity value, and he immediately understood the good thing that had happened in that respect. Quite probably he had already thought about the possibility of such a scandal when I first played him the score, months before, in the East Corner ground room of the Grand Hotel in Venice. This is one of my favorite books of the Robert Kraft era, Conversations with Igor Stravinsky. There are quite a few others, across which you can read a generous scattering of commentary about the Rite of Spring. From what the now elderly Stravinsky feels the significance of the work represents, all the way to his rating of different recordings of the Rite by other conductors, and how they compare to his recordings. You have to skip around a bit, and the self-mythologizing becomes a little tiresome after a while, but your time won't be wasted. Robert Kraft's writings with Stravinsky were hugely in vogue in the 1960s, to the point at which many libraries still contain copies in fairly good condition. In later years, Stravinsky shrugged off the identity of being a Russian composer, preferring to avoid such titles, and after the Revolution, following the premiere of The Rite of Spring, he lived the rest of his life in exile from the country of his birth. But Russia didn't forget about him. The first significant scholarly overview of his works was written and published in Russia in 1929 by composer and musicologist Boris Asafyev, called A Book About Stravinsky. Asafyev was from the same generation as Stravinsky, and had grown up experiencing many of the same personalities and situations as his subject. So Asafyev could analyze the scope of Stravinsky's output up to the late 1920s in context, though through the window of Soviet sensibilities about art rather than those of the West. The result is an outlook not too different from Stravinsky's own in retrospect, attempting to strip some of the original meaning away in order to portray the Rite of Spring as a more universal and less primitivistic work. The worship of the earth is closely connected with ancestor worship. The music of Part II is not so much concerned with the externals of primitive Slavic man's attitude toward nature, as it is with his subconscious, emotional attitudes, the sense of mystery, horror, and panic in the face of the unknown to which he has for so long made so many sacrifices as propitiation. The final, closing dance of the doomed maiden has been conceived not as character portraiture or as genre painting, but as pure symphonic movement, as indeed has almost all the music of the second half of the Rite. Introduction, mysterious circle of the adolescents, glorification of the chosen one, evocation of the ancestors, ritual action of the ancestors, and finally, the sacrificial dance. These are the phases through which the action passes. But the superficial subjects of such action are not important, and neither are the conventions of pictorialism, imagery, narrative, tone painting, and the like. I repeat, here the music expresses the confrontation of man and the phenomenon of spring's renewal. Man, prior to the creation of a personal god, hardly aware of his own separateness from nature, still half embedded in her. The opening pages of the second part convey the mystery and panic of nature's night as it is felt by adolescent maidens, for it is precisely through them that the strain of nature's growth and vernal renewal can be sensed with particular delicacy and directness. For all that, Asafyev's book provides very clear, not overly technical analyses. Stravinsky appears to have mistrusted Asafyev as a critic and hated this book, though the writing is very respectful and admiring of Stravinsky as a person and his compositions as leading works of art. a book about Stravinsky was banned by the Soviets almost immediately upon publication, and then stalled in limbo for half a century because of Stravinsky's own resistance. But due to the machinations of Robert Craft himself, this English translation was finally published in the early 1980s. Craft provides a foreword, helping put the book in context with the wealth of scholarly material about Stravinsky, to which, of course, he himself had contributed mightily. I personally find this book to be very readable and useful for the student of Stravinsky's works, especially orchestral composers interested in the scoring of The Rite of Spring. Asafyev devotes 30 pages to analyzing the Rite, breaking down some of the orchestration and exploring the overall structure of the music in an accessible way. Perhaps Stravinsky's resistance to the book had to do more with Asafyev's very knowing comments about his Russian origins and how they defined his works. But even in the area of pure melody, that is, in intonational formations whose shape, intensity, and mobility are constrained by the requirements of singability, by the dynamics of breathing, and by the uninterrupted flow of sound and pure harmonics, i.e., without the admixture of noise, even in this area, Stravinsky plants something new, again by first loosening old earth. The cultivation of melody from time immemorial, as it has come down to us by oral tradition, demonstrates that tradition had long outgrown the crude restraints of an harmonic music that dictates the assimilation of all the voices to the one which carries the principal melody. For Stravinsky, therefore, Russian folk music was not just something to which he could apply principles of development that were alien to the material itself, no matter how often this may have occurred. The folk music actually became a part of his organically developing language. His taste and technical facility made it unnatural for him to foist onto this music characteristics that were alien to it. On the contrary, by letting the folk art reveal its own qualities, vitality, and forms, he found the key to its proper artistic transmutation. Let's jump forward now, back to the 1960s, when Robert Craft was shaping a narrative around Stravinsky. The problem with the books that he wrote was that they tended to be personal, retrospective, and celebratory of Stravinsky, rather than scholarly. Actually, because of Stravinsky's hand in their writing, there could be no critical overviews or narrative biographies in this outpouring of books. That was left to other writers like Eric Walter White in his book, Stravinsky, The Composer and His Works. This book tends to trust Stravinsky's autobiography and the Robert Craft books in its biographical detail, supplemented by a few more accurate details from the historical record. It's typically scanty on the Russian birth, childhood, training, and cultural identity of the composer, then more generous as his reputation becomes established. The retelling of the Rite of Spring premiere is pure party line with the autobiography, even confusing the order of events to make Nijinsky's efforts look all the more foolish and Stravinsky's role all the more heroic. But almost inadvertently, it acknowledges the inevitable mastery of the choreography when the production moved to London. This 6 weeks illness meant that Stravinsky was unable to attend the Russian ballet season in London, which was held at the Theatre Royal, Drury Lane, where The Rite of Spring had its London premiere on 11 July. In an excess of caution, Diaghilev had arranged for Edwin Evans to appear in front of the curtain immediately before the performance to explain the music and intention of the new ballet, but the audience, excited by the atmosphere of a first night, and all eagerness to see the Rite for themselves, became restive and Evans was forced to curtail his lecture. The performance seems to have been an excellent one, and Marie Piltz, as the chosen maiden, scored a great triumph in her final dance, which was frequently interrupted by bursts of frenzied applause. She and the conductor, Monteux, had been called before the curtain and gave a great reception, but the audience's attitude to the ballet as a whole was ambivalent. Those who had gone to the theater expecting to be charmed by light and graceful movements, and instead found themselves caught up in a maelstrom of rhythm, immensely vital and as dominating as remorseless, and as irritating to the nervous system as the continuous thudding of a savage's tom-tom, bitterly resented Nijinsky's new production. Others, nonetheless startled by this attempt to reproduce in terms of choreography the stark mood of primitive man, appreciated the sincerity of both the composer and choreographer, and applauded with fervor. It would be a fair estimate to say that the audience were about equally divided in their dislike and their appreciation. The powerful originality of The Rite of Spring represented an important personal victory gained by Stravinsky over the inhibitions of his miserable childhood. For years he had tried to revolt from the stultifying restrictions of his family life, and now that he had succeeded in doing so in terms of artistic expression, it was particularly appropriate that the image that precipitated his release should have been that of spring. The violent Russian spring that seemed to begin in an hour and was like the whole world cracking, and which, by his own admission, was the most wonderful event of every year of his childhood. After 120 pages of biography, Eric Walter White drops 400 pages of analysis on us, covering nearly every Stravinsky work ever composed. This too follows the party line to a degree, and very little about The Rite of Spring's artistic context, circumstances, and origins will seem new to any reader of the other books I've mentioned so far. Certain lazy falsehoods are repeated verbatim, Stravinsky making, quote, no conscious use of Russian folk song, unquote, except for the opening bassoon solo, or the tired line that Nijinsky had no aptitude as a choreographer, when the author had already proved this wrong to himself 150 pages ago. In fact, I'd say that this book's strength is really in its overview of all of Stravinsky's works, rather than any analysis or biographical insights about The Rite of Spring itself. In fact, I probably wouldn't even bother mentioning this book at all, were it not for the fact that it's one of the most common texts out there, and you should know what I think about it before picking up a copy. There's a much, much greater biography that I'll recommend in a moment, but first, let's talk about Richard Taruskin. Everybody's got an axe to grind, including me, as you've probably noticed. Taruskin's is that the main thrust of Stravinsky's artistic identity derives from Russian origins. To 21st century students of Stravinsky, that would appear to be obvious. But part of Stravinsky's careful reshaping of his artistic identity was the notion that he was somehow above obvious cultural allegiances. We can see this in his later claim that The Rite of Spring was merely a vehicle for certain musical ideas he had at the time, and that the subject of the ballet didn't really inform those ideas. And of course, at the end of Stravinsky's life, when he was embracing serialism, he was most concerned with maintaining his place as the leader of the musical avant-garde, rather than being a relic of the beginning of the century. All the more reason to dismiss the early outpouring of Russianness in scores such as Petrushka and Firebird. As we saw in the last installment of this series, the 1980s reconstruction of the original production of The Rite of Spring overturned all these revisionist notions put forward by conventional Stravinsky scholarship. And then into the fray jumped Richard Taruskin with a hugely detailed two-volume work titled Stravinsky and the Russian Tradition. I personally don't have a copy, though I've read quite a bit of the text. And in fact, the work isn't for sale where I live or much elsewhere outside the United States, probably because of copyright issues with the extensive examples. Also, it costs well over $400 new. But it changed the whole focus of Stravinsky scholarship at one blow. Taruskin builds on the work of Lawrence Morton, the musicologist who discovered the many original melodies that Stravinsky quoted from an old Lithuanian songbook borrowed from his collaborator Nicholas Rurik, whose contribution is also explored quite extensively in this book, and rightly so. Taruskin writes in a refreshingly accessible, even rollicking style at times, and frames his complex points with creditable clarity from the very beginning. Now that the 20th century is nearing an end, it is safe to predict that Igor Stravinsky will be remembered as its most famous composer of what, in the 20th century, has become known as serious music. He was by far the most played, most recorded, most interviewed, most photographed, most talked about. Alone among composers, he led a private life that was consistently a matter of public interest, and the continuing flood of published photograph albums and scrapbooks shows that interest has not flagged since his death. He has been the subject of book-length memoirs by non-musicians. He commanded a five-figure fee for personal appearances, and his personal archive commanded seven. In short, as his wife once put it, he possessed a lot of Newman. But if he was the most famous, he is not necessarily the best known or understood. The story of his life, and even more so, of his musical development, teems with riddles. The biggest of them concern his musical origins and his early Russian period, despite the fact that it was the period of his most famous works, and despite the voluminous Stravinsky literature, so much of it contributed by the composer himself. For as his career proceeded along its spectacular course, he became increasingly embarrassed by his past, and did all he could to force it down an Orwellian memory hole. He did this not only by withholding or suppressing information, but also, more subtly, by supplying it in selective superabundance. His various accounts of his early years, given at various points during his later ones, all contradict one another, and all are in greater or lesser conflict with the ascertainable facts. Whence this celebrated mendacity? It stemmed, one has to conclude, not just from a faulty memory or from indifference to factual accuracy, but from an astonishing, chronic sense of cultural inferiority that reached a besetting climax near the end of Stravinsky's career, leaving him doubtful about the validity of his work and fretful about his place in history. Stravinsky's embarrassment offers an elegant confirmation of Prince Nikolai Trubetskoy's claim in his bitter, biting Europe and Humanity, that the enlightened cosmopolitanism of the West was really a form of chauvinism. He called it pan-Germano-Romantic chauvinism, and that Russians infected by it could not help turning hostile toward Russia. That Stravinsky was infected with this plague no one needs to prove by now. Its effects on him, however, have yet to be fully gauged. Robert Kraft informs us that, all of his life, Stravinsky complained that he had been handicapped in his youth by his isolation from an intellectually stimulating environment. Compensation is everywhere apparent in Stravinsky's writings, with their obsessively recherché vocabulary and self-conscious and, given the author, notably gratuitous, insistence, particularly with reference to serial pieces like Movements for Piano and Orchestra, on his, quote, advanced, unquote, technique. But its most stunning manifestation was something no one could have expected before the period of the serial music and the conversation books. His acknowledgement of the reality and the legitimacy of the Germanic mainstream that he had devoted a career, and for many, very persuasively, to denying. Once Stravinsky had crossed this bridge, his whole past became useless to him. There's more than a touch of friendly combativeness in Taruskin's tone, which we can read in other writings, such as in this New York Times article, where he takes Arthur Berger and Pieter van den Toorn to task for assuming that the octatonic scale, a musical mode of successive whole steps and half steps, which Berger discovered in Stravinsky's works and then named, was in some way an indication that Stravinsky was less Russian. Taruskin points out that Stravinsky's teacher Rimsky-Korsakov also used the octatonic scale, and so did all his pupils. In fact, he may have borrowed it from Liszt, who in turn borrowed it from Schubert. The author and musicologist Pieter van den Toorn became so interested in how the octatonic scale manifested itself that he wrote an entire treatise on it called The Music of Igor Stravinsky. And it's definitely not for lightweights. Every page is loaded with extremely technical writing, such as this. Le sax 0-2-3-5, 0-11, and 0-5-11 globally defined framework is conceived primarily in terms of a partitioning of the 0-2-3-5-6-8-9-11 octatonic collection, Model B, and of the 0-2-3-5-7-9-10, 0, diatonic collection, D scale, in which the 0-2-3-5 octatonic partitioning relates to a 0-4-7-10 dominant seventh partitioning, Model A, by means of the frequent 0-2-5 incomplete articulation of the 0-2-3-5 tetrachords. These octatonic, diatonic, and octatonic-diatonic relations, being symmetrical and hence inherently static, non-progressive, or inconclusive in some tonally conceived progressive, developmental, or cadential sense, being coagulated stuff, to return to the commentary of Pierre Boulez, irreducible aggregations, are linked to, or may be said to prompt, a form constructed with relatively stable, self-contained blocks of material, These blocks are often abruptly cut off, without resolution or cadential formulation, and subjected to near repeats in their respective contexts, at which points they acquire the unusual degree of distinction and insulation marked not only in instrumentation, tempo, dynamics, and or rhythmic metric design, but perhaps most critically in referential character. I'm not reading this to make fun of Van den Toorn. I get exactly what he's saying, though there are simpler ways to say it. I'm just saying that if you love that kind of atomic detail, then this is definitely the book for you. If not, then go to your university or conservatory library and see if you can borrow the Taruskin, which covers some of the same material, but in a more involving, less mathematical way. Pretty much everything written since the 1990s has been influenced by Taruskin. I'll finish this lecture with two of my favorites. My most highly recommended texts, in fact. If you want an accurate, detailed biography of Stravinsky that's very well researched and readable, then try Stephen Walsh's book, Stravinsky, A Creative Spring. This is volume one of a two-volume set, following Stravinsky's life right up to the year before his autobiography was published. The most unique thing about it is its in-depth view of Stravinsky's childhood and musical development. We see his early musical instructors not as exasperating caricatures, but for the professionals they were and the positions they held in Russian artistic life. We read that Stravinsky's family fortunes were tied to the successes and failures of his opera singer father, and vividly illustrated are the relationships, artistic progress, and politics of the time that shaped Stravinsky's early triumphs to come. Particularly vivid are certain portrayals, such as the composer Rimsky-Korsakov, which set right some of Stravinsky's revisionism.
A tall old man who wore his beard and his frock coat at right angles and with no curves apart from the two circles of his spectacles.
Rimsky-Korsakov cut a decidedly stiff, authoritarian figure in the introverted, provincial world of St. Petersburg music. Stravinsky's later reminiscence that
he played his first composition to please Rimsky-Korsakov with the warning that should it fail to please, he would continue composing just the same.
Is hard to take seriously in view of the intimidating circumstances and Rimsky-Korsakov's notorious sharpness of tongue. It also conflicts with the sycophantic tone of the young man's subsequent letters to his teacher. The truth is that Rimsky-Korsakov exacted, and was accorded, the hierarchical niceties by all his junior colleagues. Any other attitude would have been unthinkable. The relationship was an essentially structured one, and reflected the master's obsession with system and organization, and his genuine fear of disorder, in part a legacy of his desperate battle with his own technical deficiencies in his early years as a professor of composition. A great deal of what Stravinsky later said or wrote about music, in his autobiography, in The Poetics of Music, in The Conversations, can be traced back to Rimsky-Korsakov. It may even be that the very habit of self-contradiction, without which the mature Stravinsky would be inconceivable, had its essential origins in Rimsky-Korsakov's deep-rooted tendency to cover his inspirational and emotional traces, and also incidentally explains Stravinsky's own profound ambivalence toward his teacher. Where the two composers differ, of course, is in the all-important matter of how these limitations and contradictions acted on their own music. Though even here there is an unacknowledged and by no means wholly negative influence. One thing that we don't read in most Stravinsky biographies is what this book makes very clear. His father's long illness and then death caused the young composer to look for a strong father figure in Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov. So when this beloved teacher passed away right as Stravinsky started to come into his own, the loss was doubly painful. All the more so when Rimsky-Korsakov's family distanced themselves from the young genius's successes in Paris. In reference to the St. Petersburg premiere of concert excerpts of Petrushka, I see the St. Petersburg newspapers are now all comparing my work to the smashing of crockery, Stravinsky told the Daily Mail. In fact, the press for Koussevitzky's performance was by no means universally negative, though Stravinsky may well have tired of being told, by even sympathetic critics who had not yet seen his ballet and had only heard half the score, that the work needed the stage to make an impact, that, as Alexander Kopyaev put it, Mr. Stravinsky detests mere music, and on the whole gives his music only an insignificant role in the general impression. This music longs for 100 stamping feet on the stage. But what must in particular have stuck in his craw was a single review by the critic of the Ruskaya Molva, who stated paradoxically that, if it weren't for the great gifts of Benoit and Stravinsky, this piece with its vulgar motives would be a monstrous crime. Yet who knows? Might not Petrushka be the prelude to its own kind of musical futurism? If so, then perhaps it would be better if it had never seen the light. Even here, there was no smashing crockery, only glittering scraps and the clatter of bells. But no wonder such images became twisted in Stravinsky's mind when their author was his erstwhile dear friend, Andrei Rimsky-Korsakov. Andrei was the son of Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov and was like a brother to Stravinsky, and he wasn't the only friend to turn his back on the composer. So did several others, and their betrayal is all spelled out here. You can also read a heavy influence of the revelations due to the original production restoration and the work of Richard Taruskin in these pages. At times, some of this seems subjective, but is probably closer to the truth than many more scholarly analyses about the working methods that produced the Rite of Spring. In its origins, the Rite of Spring had stayed broadly faithful to the world of art nationalism of Petrushka. It was an artificial recreation of some folk reality, not meant to be accurate or realistic as Stasov or Mussorgsky would have understood those terms, and certainly not conveying a Stasovian social message, but still by intention profoundly true to the spirit of the culture from which it derived its subject matter and materials. In other words, it was still a work of Russian nationalism, much indebted to Rimsky-Korsakov's ideas of a properly researched use of ethnic materials, while plainly rejecting the academic pedantries with which Rimsky-Korsakov had fenced his own and his pupils' work. At the same time, it absorbed a lot of the theurgic wing of nationalist art. Its violence was not only primitive, it was modern, proto-revolutionary, destructive as well as recreative, oppressive as well as liberating. Above all, it was excessive. It lacked restraint and moderation. It preached self-annihilation through the senses, just as much as it observed it through the window of Rurik's imaginative archaeology. It was romantic self-absorption gone mad. How much of this was conscious, on either Rurik's or Stravinsky's part, is of relatively little consequence. Insofar as it was in the work, Stravinsky became aware of it and rejected it. But the way the music was written, its internal mechanisms, intrigued him more and more. Sitting at his upright piano, picturing to himself the little old woman in her squirrel skins, or the young girls with their painted faces, or the chosen one dancing herself into the frozen earth, he did not simply crash around on the keyboard like an angry child looking for the most repellent cacophony he could find, as some critics chose to imagine. His work was painstaking and the results systematic. This is not to say that the violence of the concept, its sheer animal force, had no bearing on the musical technique. On the contrary, he looked for types of chords which could convey the human terror of the action. But having found them, in a particular kind of transparent dissonance, transparent in the sense that one can perfectly well hear the simple elements it consists of, he then used that type of chord as a binding motif, one which could be varied in many different ways, while keeping its essential character intact. He found that he could combine melodies in the same way, not smoothly, as in a round or a Bach fugue, but harshly according to certain regular patterns. And later he noticed that he could combine them in and out of phase, so that the harmony fluctuated within predictable but not necessarily pre-planned limits. As for the rhythm, that too could work transparently, by varying basic patterns in a simple additive or subtractive way, which kept the patterns clear while disrupting their even flow. Which leaves me with one final book to recommend. Pieter Hill's wonderfully concise Cambridge Music Handbook, Stravinsky, The Rite of Spring. In fact, I think that every serious student of The Rite of Spring should own a copy, as an introductory guide to the history and content of the work. It boils down many, many things I've read in dozens of other books into one essential document. The preface is a joy to read rather than a chore. For many people, The Rite of Spring is the first masterpiece of the 20th century to break completely with the past. The paradox is that it is also a work more deeply rooted in tradition than any other Stravinsky composed. The music is based on a scenario devised by Stravinsky with Nikolai Rurik, artist, archaeologist, and expert on folk art and customs. The seriousness with which they approach their task resulted in a work unique in Stravinsky's output for the absence of irony or theatrical artifice. The Rite is third in the trio of ballets, which Stravinsky composed for Diaghilev's Ballet Russe between 1910 and 1913. The scandal attending the Rite's premiere on 29 May 1913 became legendary. It also marked Stravinsky for life. Partly because it was so controversial, the Rite must be surrounded by anecdote, myth, and hearsay through which the historian must sift, aware that much is contradictory or otherwise unreliable. Much of the problem stems from Stravinsky himself, who tried in later years to distance the music from its dramatic origins. This preface is followed by a frank discussion of the Rite of Spring's origins, Stravinsky's sources, sketches, and working methods, and more reliable information about the riotous premiere than usual. The middle section of the book provides well-thought-out analysis and discussion of Stravinsky's musical language and structures. Then the end of the book does a lot of myth-busting, with very revealing contemporary accounts of the premiere, an honest look into Stravinsky's working relationships and attitudes in the early 19-teens, and a movement-by-movement discussion of the challenges posed by performing the Rite of Spring, and how different conductors and orchestras overcame, or failed, those challenges in recordings. Pieter Hill's conclusion seems to lay down a challenge for all modes of Stravinsky scholarship, from Asafyev to Kraft to Taruskin. All music, and the Rite is no exception, tends to be remade in a way that reflects the era of its performer. In most performances of the Rite, the work remains a collage of unmotivated if spectacular events, lacking the gripping sense of evolution conveyed by early recordings. Very possibly behind this lies the prevailing analytic and historical conception of the Rite as being constructed of static blocks, a narrow view which this book has attempted to question. Certainly, the vast literature on the Rite hardly mentions Stravinsky's architectural achievement. His ideas and techniques are discussed out of context with little or no attention paid to the music's architecture. In reality, one of the work's most fascinating aspects, and the one which explains its mesmerizing hold on the listener. The cause of this omission lies in the traditional critical view, which classifies the Rite as a pure example of early 20th century modernism, with Stravinsky represented as working in total reaction to all musical precedent. Despite the recent work on Stravinsky's origins, this dogma seems obstinately entrenched, all but set in stone. And as you'll read, he even counts Taruskin in that criticism. Now, let's change gears to some score analysis, which I am happy to share publicly with the whole Orchestration Online community this month.
So here we are, halfway through the Rite of Spring, and, you know, after 6 months of analysis and lectures and everything else, it's just really been fun bringing all of this to you, and I'm really looking forward to the second half over the next 6 months. So let's start right at the very beginning of this page and look at, you know, what is Stravinsky doing here? And basically, it's a very simple idea, alternating between two minor chords in not very related keys, right? This is D-sharp minor and C-sharp minor, just kind of going back and forth and so on. but, you know, all harmonic structure aside, what's really fascinating is how Stravinsky is able to get monumentally huge, beautiful, cushioned textures that are incredibly soft, right? You know, even though it says like mezzo forte here, it quickly diminishes down to pianissimo, right? And, you know, continuing on, right, we just really see that there's a great deal of complexity and, you know, just wonderful sounds and wonderful ideas all put together, and they almost never really rise to, in this whole intro section, they never really rise to a forte, right? So you have to remember that the audience would have been watching the screen in the original production, right? So this is just introductory music. And if you've watched some of those movies or reconstructions or so on,
You know that the audience was just getting more and more angry, the more reactionary elements in the audience who just didn't like all this crazy new modern stuff. And this is really the point at which the ballet started to get out of control in the original premiere. The audience started to just lose its mind. You know, they had been sort of provoked a bit by the very aggressive music, especially at the end of the first part. But for some reason, this beautiful, peaceful, and incredibly eerie music is what really got them going and got them to protest the loudest and the most ferociously by the time the curtain came up. And, you know, they were just really, you know, out for blood. So that just, it's, you know, it's kind of another another wonderful contradiction built into this music. Because, you know, from when I was a child, I listened to it and I didn't think that, I thought it was like the most beautiful part of the entire ballet myself, you know. Anyhow, let's look at how the first page is constructed here. This is really where you get into the level of genius. And, you know, genius doesn't necessarily mean that things have to be complex. In fact, things can be extremely simple, but just unprecedented. In the case right here of what the winds are doing, I would say it is genius and it is unprecedented. You've got the flutes, you know, right in their softest register right in here, inside the staff, you know, going all the way down to C sharp here. And then they are sort of surrounded on either side by the clarinets. Now, don't be fooled by the way that this looks. You know, this almost looks like it is in the same range. But since this is an E-flat clarinet, everything is sounding up a minor third. So this is actually D-sharp and G-sharp, kind of just flopping back and forth underneath the flutes in that really shallow, shallow register, to go along with the harmony that is being played by the flutes in the middle, right? And then above, you have the standard B-flat clarinets just kind of just alternating back and forth between different parts of those same chords, right? So it just really gives this incredibly spooky kind of throbbing sound, gently pulsing sound. Now, the way that Stravinsky frames this idea, this is really what everything that is going on here, with just a tiny bit of motive, right, that is starting to break in. He frames this by adding very, very soft horns. Now notice that they are not muted, right? So muted horn is not necessarily softer. I mean, if you've got a mute on a brass instrument, you can really push it way, 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 way down if you want to, but that's not the purpose of the mute. The purpose of the mute is to change the sound of the instrument, not to necessarily make it softer. So, you know, you don't really need that, right? So look at how this is all put together. It's just incredibly soft. Once again, this is old notation, right? So notes in bass clef are actually sounding up a perfect fourth, right? So this is not actually in the harmony of what else is going on here, and that makes it even more kind of spooky, right? Same thing here, these A's that are being held. This must have been one of those moments where the players in the orchestra for the original rehearsals must have thought, look, isn't that an A sharp? I mean, the flutist is playing an A sharp. No, it's an A. You know, same thing here. The low horns were playing an A here and a D here. So you know, everything is sort of off by a half step in the framing of it, right? And even here, the strings are coming in, right, and playing an A and a E fifth, both in natural harmonics, kind of the lowest natural harmonics you can get on the double bass. And then the same thing here, there's a little harmonic D here, which is the octave harmonic of the D string, in the cellist's D string. So yeah, it's just, you know, it's wonderfully alien. right, and macabre. And I think that this is one of the places where Stravinsky is just trying his hardest to evoke a forgotten world, a culture that is completely lost, right? But at the same time, I don't think that he's trying to be inhuman, right? I don't think he's trying to be alien. I think he just wants to be, you know, very, very different, right? So this is, I think this is supposed to be touchingly, you know, evocative of the piety, right? The devotion that these people had to their gods, right? Their ancient pagan gods. And, you know, this whole section of ballet is going to end with some of the most violent music ever composed, right? So, you know, so he's starting everything off just with, you know, this real reverent, you know, really out there music. Okay, so the strings just sort of, and the trumpets kind of interject these little accompaniments to the harmony. And notice that when the trumpets come in, the muted trumpets, by the way, almost everything is muted below from the trumpets down. The flutes sort of do a little arcing motion as they come in. So it sort of compensates a little bit, right? And then, of course, that's not really needed when the first and second violins do their thing, because they're not really pushing, you know, they're not really obliterating this lovely back and forth pulsing, right? Because they're a much softer instrument in terms of their projection. And now, notice that Stravinsky is starting to use the word flautando, right? And flautando is, it's sort of like three things in one, you know? The first thing is, it's a light touch of the bow on the strings. It is tending towards the fingerboard, but not exactly sul tasto. You know, the flautando tends to be played a little closer to the fingerboard. But it's not really that position, because you can play flautando, you know, pretty much anywhere. And it is also a sort of a faster motion of the bow. So it's like soft, but fast, but, you know, kind of less less engaged of a sound, which gives it a flute-like sound, right? And so that's going to be used in a lot of different places. Now, moving on, Stravinsky has been interjecting these little, you know, ba-da, right? And he's just getting ready to really, really set up this big, soft tutti. So he has the flutes just very slowly climb up as these are pushed, right? These are nice little pushes. What's really great about composing this softly is that a lot of things can be equalized, right? So, you know, if you've got these muted violas and cellos and basses, they can sort of dovetail into what the horns are doing, right? Except for this one single concert D that continues onwards throughout this, you know, throughout this little climb. So the strings can come right in almost as if the horns are transmuting into a string-like sound, because with such a soft touch, instruments can really just like blend and merge into one another in a way that they can't when they're pushed and their unique timbres become more and more brilliant and colorful and piercing, right? In this soft sort of texture, it's very easy to get those kinds of blends. So here we get into a place where the trumpets are rising up through the different back and forth minor chords, and the oboes are climbing down, right? And this is going to be one of the highest standard notes, G flat, way up high. I mean, oboes can go all the way up to about G sharp, sometimes even an A, although it's a very uncomfortable, horrible note. But, you know, Stravinsky knows what he's doing. The oboe players of that time could easily hit that G flat out of nowhere, right? That's the trick for double reed instruments is, are you able just to start a pitch beautifully right on with good intonation and, you know, and then do whatever you need to do from there. It sort of reminds me of the Daphnis and Chloe oboe solo as well that starts off very, very high. Now, it's a little easier because it's mezzo forte rather than being, you know, piano, pianissimo, which is just very hard to control. So it's easier to start with a more firm type of articulation for the oboe player. So anyway, so this is sort of working its way down. And you notice what happens is the trumpets meet up with the oboes, right, at a certain point. And sort of merge into them, right? And then as the oboes get down to this particular part of their arc, the flutes come back in and sort of interlace with them and then take over the whole kind of twisty back and forth. It's like a wave. It's more than just a curve, right? It's a wave. So it's a wonderful way of, you know, getting that more nasal sound of oboes and muted trumpets, and then having them merge together, right? Because they're a very closely related sound, which is something that the French orchestrators were exploring at that time, and, you know, something that that Stravinsky, as a student of Rimsky-Korsakov, would have well known. And then blending that together with the flutes. You know, I feel like in these two pages, Stravinsky has left his master so far behind, or elevated some of his master's principles, Rimsky-Korsakov's principles, you know, so far ahead. I mean, this is really kind of showing you what you can do with Rimsky-Korsakov's book. You know, what is the kind of extrapolation of how far that possible kind of training and those philosophies can go. Now, notice while this little surging back and forth is going on, it's got some help from the first and second violins. And there's a background which is just wonderfully put together of flutes, English horn, clarinets, bassoons and horns, right? So it's just a very powerfully, you know, this is a very kind of a Russian kind of a sound and voicing of everything that's happening behind it. And once again, not really related to the harmony of all the other, you know, this surging line. And then of course, you know, the trombones and tubas below. And just to point out a little notation thing, and that is that the oboes and tubas have got ottava above in the oboes and ottava bassa for the tubas, and that would not really be in the part, and it's only in the full score because it's so vertically compressed, right? So that's one of those things that I think it's acceptable if you've got, you know, this many staves on a page and you're worried that it just will become unreadable if you score it out exactly, you know, the way that the players are going to read it. So that is one of those places where it is acceptable to put an ottava mark over, say, like a wind part or under a brass part or whatever. But don't put it in the part, all right? It's just a sort of a full score emergency concept. Here is where you get into muted tuba, okay? And you know, once again, I mean, just like the horns, a tuba does not really need a mute on it. A tuba player can play remarkably soft. You can get this incredible, you know, triple P sound off out of the tuba and still hear the tuba really, really clearly in a texture like this. The cone that the mute is made out of is a really huge thing. In fact, this is kind of a joke. A tuba player I know has actually, you know, he found an old abandoned road cone. And he just made that into his mute, and he actually nailed it to a board. And so, and it actually looks really professional. Like it's you know, the board is painted this wonderful black, and I think he also painted the road cone. And, you know, fixed it on with wire, and it just, you know, it looks like something that you would buy from a, you know, buy from an elite, instrument maker type of catalog. Okay. But it is a road cone on a board. And it's actually, I think it's much easier because he uses the board as a handle. So, you know, just very easy to, put into his bell and take out of it without damaging his tuba. So now let's drop a little bit further. We've got rolls from the bass drum, okay, ending with triple P here. And we've also got like this double roll on timpani. So actually, if this is one player, then the player is actually going to be alternating the sticks back and forth on the heads, right? Rather than it being really like a very, very tight roll. It's going to be a looser kind of a roll. And I think that that sort of adds to the mystery of it, right? Now, you could actually have individual players each playing the rolls, right? And just get a very clean or much, much more clean roll. But I think it's actually kind of cool the way it is if that's one player. And then, you know, there are just to point out a few cool things in the strings here. This is going to be a harmonic and that's sort of played as a touch four. It's a natural harmonic, but it's played as a touch four. And so you get the note two octaves above. And then he wants you to release the touch four and then continue playing on. Now, that is actually something that is kind of has mixed results because the harmonic wants to hold on after you've let go, right? So, you know, that Stravinsky must have known what would have happened in that situation. And it sort of, you know, it's not the cleanest sound, but it does fit in with this wonderfully kind of back and forth surging idea, all right? Now, this just basically is going to repeat three times, okay? And what happens in between that? Instead of this sort of reaching upward idea, the strings introduce a fragment of the melody that is to come, right? The sort of the main theme of this entire section, you know, da 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 da. But in case it's just here, it's just da 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 da, right? And it's all played with harmonics, flautando, right? So a very light touch on the bow, very fast bow. And just playing these, you know, these very, very high harmonics, which are probably is just easier to play as artificial harmonics, right? Stravinsky doesn't often indicate in the Rite of Spring, if, you know, I mean, here it's pretty obvious what he wants, right? So the player will just be completely set up to do that. And in this case, they might actually set things up not on the natural harmonic of the A string. They might actually probably set it up on the D string below so that they can control this and sort of kind of go back and forth. And then they can just get the natural harmonic of the D string here. So just be a little bit easier. But, you know, I'm not, I have never played this as a string player myself. So, I will leave it up to the experts rather than trying to, you know, appear to be an authority on the exact means of playing every string phrase just because, you know, I played viola when I was a teenager. But, you know, basically the same idea, right? Notice we've gone to treble clef here, right? So the same idea in the violas an octave lower, right? And it just makes for a beautiful, and, you know, then we've got our, you know, essentially we've got our triple octave here, you know, from coming from the cellos, right? So it just has this wonderfully spooky sound. Everybody kind of doing the same thing. And then going back into, you know, our sort of pulsing descent, ascent. And then, you know, once again, we have a little bit more of the melody. He basically states, Stravinsky states the entire basic idea of the melody here. Da, 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 da. Right? As things sort of rise. And it's because he needs the two extra beats, he has a little bit more of the flutes rising and a little bit farther than they did before, right? And then just this crushing, I just feel like this is, you know, it's a very desolate kind of idea, you know, just really, one of the girls who is about to dance in this mysterious circle, which we'll talk about next month, just knows, you know, that their number is up. So it just puts psychological pressure on the listener, I feel. And, it's not a depressive kind of a thing. You know, it's not necessarily like melancholy. And, you know, some people have said, oh, well, it's, you know, it's Stravinsky writing in a kind of a horror way, like, you know. And I don't think that it's horror either. I think that it's really meant to be reverential, you know, to kind of take the listener kind of out of their comfort zone, really. And so that they are really open to whatever the sun god Yarilo or that, you know, that Rurik is talking about in his notes. So, you know, bringing back the spirits of nature to the frozen wasteland, you know, they felt that that was their responsibility, right? So it was an awesome one that was, you know, they, a lot of these ancient cultures had the idea that they were personally responsible, you know, their tribe was personally responsible for bringing back the forces of nature to their particular country or land or whatever. And, you know, if they didn't do these rituals, then, you know, then the gods would be angry or sulky or whatever. And they wouldn't, you know, maybe if they did their ritual wrong or things didn't work out right, they might not have a good year for their crops or their, you know, or something awful would happen to them. So they had to do these rituals with complete and total reverence and focus and dedication. So I think that's part of it too, which I actually find is kind of stultifying. You know, it's a culture which didn't have a lot of freedoms, right? So I think that's part of it as well, of what Stravinsky is referencing here. That just with that, you know, with this awesome mood, you know, he was in charge. Like Rurik might have been helping him to figure out, you know, what the essential identity of each of these movements were, but Stravinsky was the guy who was in charge of the mood, right? Of exactly the way that it would work out. And I think he does just something incredible here. Now, I love this descending, we've got Sulpont, okay? Sulponticello, right? And like he says, sul ponticello to up to the sign, right? So it gives people a place to cut off the sul ponticello. And, you know, it's still going to be a very, very light touch here. Possibly played punta d'arco, you know, just right at the tip of the bow. And, you know, these would be all played as artificial harmonics. Just very, very slowly descending. And notice that the position of the flutes has basically changed, right? It doesn't really have, it doesn't need the kind of coating of clarinets around it, right? It's sort of taken over that sort of back and forth, the same back and forth idea of the, that the clarinets had before. And the piccolo is playing fairly low, you know, sort of in the middle to lower register, and which has some beautifully spooky, luminous sounds as well. Now, underneath it, this is something that I forgot to mention, and I will mention now, and that is this wonderful idea of the alto flute playing octaves underneath the harmonics of the violin and, you know, in very high pitches, very high, soft pitches, in the other flutes, okay? And here is just what I feel is another stroke of genius. So let's remember our G transposition, right? So this is also an A, right? So this is an A being held an octave below this A, which is the same as this A, right? Because piccolo transposes at the octave, right? So this is basically this very, very high note is being played by by the piccolo, plus with the, you know, the alto flute is not a very strong instrument. So it is contributing overtones, right? And that is the sort of the wonderful thing that happens more and more in this piece, or in this section. You'll see the alto flute being used to support from below. And it's so, you know, it's such a subtle instrument and so kind of soft and, you know, kind of almost a hoarse softness. And that kind of blends into things that are happening above that are extremely clear, right? It's a very, very tricky idea. All right. So I'm just setting this up here, which I'll talk about in a second, okay? So as the flutes are just doing their thing, going back and forth and supported somewhat by very soft muted strings, and everybody else is sort of descending in tremolo, you've got these beautiful harmonies here. And notice as the violins descend, the harmony is ascending, right? And it's basically clarinets and horns. And clarinets and horns together, when they are playing very, very softly in the background, also contribute to a somewhat luminous idea. If you've got these flutes sort of kind of throbbing back and forth like this, and you've got the horns and the clarinets playing very softly in the background, which is also kind of a square wave sound, like flutes, clarinets, and horns also have a very related waveform. Then it just really contributes to just a beautifully nocturnal. When I hear this, I sort of think of moonlight over whatever dance is going to happen ominously to come. Okay, so as the strings rise, the oboes basically just take over what's going on with the flutes. Okay, and that's a very cool thing. It frees up the flutes to do more things coming up, or just to get a breath after all that has happened over those first few pages. It's not necessarily easier to play soft for some instruments. In fact, high soft notes are very, very difficult on brass instruments. You know, people would probably rather just play loudly up there for, you know, a horn or a trumpet. And, you know, it doesn't take as much breath necessarily, but it's not really about breath. It's more about the force on the embouchure, right? All right, so let's not get too technical. Let's have a listen right up here to this rehearsal mark 83. So here's an example of what I was talking about, okay? First, to just completely set everything up, the strings have kind of crawled up, bridging between the flutes and the oboes. And now the oboes are basically just kind of going back and forth, you know, between different kinds of minor chords. The lower strings are taking over what the what the clarinets and horns were doing before. And this is almost seamless with a good orchestra. You know, just really, you feel, of course, you've got some lower notes in there, obviously. But it sort of feels like it all just comes together and it kind of seamlessly goes from one into another. It has a different quality, to be sure, but it doesn't obtrude into the music the same way that this doesn't, but it supports it beautifully. And then, of course, the juicy bit is this, and that is solo violin and alto flute, right? Okay, so what is going on here? Okay, well, the solo violin is playing a high C sharp, right? And so is, you know, the C sharp as well. Let's remember our G transposition. This is sounding down a perfect fourth. So this is two octaves below the violin solo. And so what, you know, basically the complex overtones, the very kind of hollow, woody overtones of the alto flute are contributing to this beautiful line up here. And without it, it would be much, much less luminous. Then, of course, you have the actual root tone of the alto flute, not just its overtones, but its root tone is sort of providing this rock from below. And what's cool about it is when you listen to this, you may not, you know, if you're not score reading and you're not paying any attention, you may just hear this and not even think of that root tone that's happening below it, right? You might just think, oh wow, what a beautiful violin solo. You might not think, oh, what a beautiful violin solo and alto flute below it, right? It just might not even occur to you, especially as the oboes are basically crawling all over the same range as this poor alto flute player. But because they're in sync, because the alto flute and the solo violin are in sync, they manage to sort of lock in together and defeat the interference of the oboes somewhat. So flipping back forward, we can see there's kind of more of the same, right? Now notice that Stravinsky sort of tends to kind of chop around his melodies, all right, and kind of cut and paste certain ideas going forward and going back, right? So, you know, so you're starting off with this, you know, da 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 da. So this just cut right off and just goes straight back to, you know, da 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 da. Sorry about my tuneless singing. I'm probably just completely, you know, off the wrong key of what I'm singing, but I just, you know, I have a really clear idea in my head, which sort of seems to go up and down by a few half steps from day to day, as I'm just listening to it in my mind. So notice though that the strings are a little bit various here, right? Now it's really the surrounding details that I want you to pay attention to, right? Not just sort of say, oh wow, there is the melody. I really enjoyed looking at that melody. Great, I know everything I need to know about this section of the piece. Now on to the next one. That is not the way an orchestrator can think, right? You have to notice everything, right? So let's notice what is going on. We've got our second violin's divisi, right? We've got our violas, and we've got our cello below, right? Okay, and yeah, they're basically holding on to this stuff, right? And then when everybody else comes in, we're just basically making a space here for these four solo violas, right? These are the other violas right in here, viole altri. And they're going to continue on right here, and just for a bit, right? Up to about here. And as this comes to an end, Stravinsky dovetails in this lovely rising figure here. And then we get this beautifully harmonized, very spookily harmonized section with all violas. And, you know, here's more orchestrational mastery, is that he could have done this with just violins as a standard thing, kind of just going to them because they are, you know, he could have had all the first violins do this, right? That they're not doing anything. However, the sound of the viola is just so different when it's playing up high like this from the violin, right? When we are pushing it out of its normal register, right? Not necessarily crossing voices because there isn't a voice to cross, but you know, getting the viola out of its sort of standard area of playing and sort of pushing it up into the more standard register of the violins, then it just has this wonderfully macabre sound. And you know, and also just trying to underline how different this is from regular standard concert music of the day, right? Especially with these really, you know, strange, you know, what I feel is very sweet. It's a very sweet kind of chord voicings, but still very strange the way that they're put together, all right? Especially with this this B double flat up here. And then underneath these kind of rising hooking octaves, right? Which is what is going on here, right? So we're basically going from F to F with a little G flat hooking above it, right? Each time. And then here, Stravinsky does not even bother to hook. He just puts in the hook note and then goes back down to F a ninth below, right? And then just reverses his way down, right? So now let's have a listen to this page, and then we'll pick it up on the next page. So I hope I didn't distract you too much by going off of that analysis and talking about the strings too much, and that you did pay attention to the alto flute supporting the solo violin, because that was a really great feature. You know, I thought that was the most unusual thing about that whole passage we just listened to. So if you just go back and listen to it now and you know, sorry about that. Now, moving on to, you know, this particular section. This is actually sort of part one of two particular treatments of this same idea. So we're just going to take them one by one and do it, you know, analyze these two pages and listen to it and then move on to the next one, all right? So here comes a new theme to be added. And what's really cool about this is the way that Stravinsky has composed this, right? He's come up with this new, really catchy idea, and it is going to dominate the next four pages. However, here, he doesn't really want to let go of what just happened before, right? So it's almost like the past passage is interlacing slightly with the passage to come. Right? So, you know, here we've got the trumpets going, you know, da, 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 and then the strings kind of sigh, or the five solo cellos sigh. They just go, da, da, right? It's almost like saying, oh, I don't want to give up on what we just did. And, you know, I think that this is just really lovely. Once again, it's the same kind of idea as we heard before with the violas, right? The cellos are kind of going into the viola area, and they're kind of expressing their very kind of very chesty sound in that area. Of course, cellos being played up in their tenor register is no big deal. It's not really, you know, it's not a register that is really necessarily voice crossing or out of place for them, but it still has a kind of an eerie sound. This, I just love this little sigh here. Okay, and this is kind of a paraphrase of the of the melody, you know, instead of da 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 da, we have da 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 da, right? You know, it's almost like that same thing turned upside down, right? And changed a little bit. And once again, we've got the same hooking kind of phrase, right? So, you know, going up a ninth and then back down a step to the octave, right? So, and that just sort of goes throughout this entire string section, and it's just really, really beautiful. Now, I know this looks incredibly expanded, but it's just because you've got your five cello soloists and the rest of the cellists all playing the same note on the way down. But, you know, you could just cut these entire five bars out and then just, you know, perceive this as five lines of music. And that would be, like, you know, proportionally more accurate to your psychology. Okay. Yeah, there's more I could say about this. Like, you know, we could explore this little F sharp harmonic right in the middle, but that's all right. Let's just keep going. So we're coming back to the same exact idea on trumpets. Now notice how he varies things around. You know, essentially it's a 5-4 idea, right? And very much in keeping with, what I feel, the kind of naturalness of 5-4 to Russian composers, because you know, there are a lot of kind of folk origins to odd time music, and so there's a kind of very natural feeling, like say the second movement of the, you know, Tchaikovsky Sixth Symphony is also in 5-4, and it was a very, very natural way. Now occasionally he adds a beat to it, right? So so instead of just skipping in the second trumpet part from A flat to F, he walks down A flat G F, right? And he just adds a second B flat to the melody above. Now notice how Stravinsky ties these together, and I think that's almost more for the convenience of the score reader or the conductor than it is really for the player. The player would probably be happy just to read this, you know, as single notes, except for when the beat came together, you know, in the middle of the bar. Or the, you know, we had when you should traditionally bridge between two notes right before the median of the bar. But, you know, whatever, not to get too much into that. And this just sort of continues on, just this very beautiful, lonely sound, almost like calling everybody together, right? This is an imagination of an ancient pagan ritual, right? So it just brings everything together, like all this sort of sobbing, sighing, seething sound before, you know, almost might seem to be like the collective sound of everybody's, you know, spirit coming together for the extreme seriousness of what is about to happen. You know, somebody's about to give up their life so that the rest of the community can survive, right? That's really what's, if you boil it down. But then you kind of come down to the individual, you know, that really, I feel like this is like the loneliest thing in the entire piece, is just this little statement, all right? Now, as it continues, and, you know, it pretty much continues without a whole lot of variation, you know, except for like this little 6-4 bar. We have these little suspense music, right? Which just is bringing people even more on edge. And, you know, I mean, what's the ritual purpose of this in Stravinsky's mind? Maybe to sort of amp up the feeling of suspense for the audience that something really is going to happen here, something extremely serious and, you know, and dire for this poor maiden, you know, who's going to sacrifice herself. You know, we don't know which one yet, do we? Right? And how is that going to happen? And, you know, what horrible thing is going to occur? Yeah, but just very, you know, this is the kind of music that was, you know, endlessly imitated in cinematic music. And It ends, I'm going to be starting the next section by turning the page, okay? But it ends with this wonderful upsweep, okay? So just try to remember this. And we're going to see other examples of it on the next page. But we'll just go over it really quickly. So you've got your sopranino clarinet, which is, you know, sounding up a minor third. And then you've got your violins. It's like consort, so with mutes, divided in three, right? So this is three players on each part. Okay, with the tip of the bow, a punta d'arco, right? And here we've got a little chart of, you know, of the notes that the player is playing over in the bottom group. With pizzicato in the part, as well as arco. And then you've got the viola just sort of breezing over this this harmonic glissando, right? So the first note of the glissando is the octave C harmonic, right? And then if you remember your harmonic series, right? So this is the second harmonic of the, or the second partial of the series, right? So second, third, fourth, fifth is the major third, you know, two and a half or two and a third octaves above the root. And then from there, you know, you have the fifth and then the sort of out of tune minor seventh, right? So this is just sort of riffing over the low C strings, natural harmonics in a glissando, right? Which we've covered in, I've covered in some of my courses. Of what that is, right? So basically, it's just kind of riffing over a C dominant seventh harmony. And notice, you know, if you see an E flat clarinet playing something in A major, that means that it's in C major, right? Right. Okay. So yeah, and all the way up to this G, which is a B flat, right? Which would make it a C dominant seventh chord, right? Okay. So now, sorry, I didn't mean to get you all distracted in this one thing. I really want you to focus on those particular features as we go through of the, you know, the sound of these muted trumpets, which are just really terrifically, you know, desolate, right? We've seen the community spirit of awe, right? And then now we're seeing the individual sense of awe. I feel that that's what is meant to be expressed here, if there was any kind of programmatic meaning at all intended. But yeah, and then once again, the reaction of the solo cellos, this hooking motion as it goes through, and the horns sort of do a riff on the opening theme. Okay, and then of course the little suspenseful reactions from the violas and cellos. All right, so listen for all those things and get ready for this, and I will see you on the next page. Okay, so we've seen all of the different elements, the basic different elements that go into the main idea of this particular section just introduced before, right? You know, we have that da 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 kind of idea, and we've got the little you know, ta-ka-ta, bum 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 bum. You know what I mean? We've got all that going on. So what, you know, how is Stravinsky going to develop the idea, not necessarily like as a thematic development, but as a coloristic development, right? It's very much into coloristic development, just adding more color and more, you know, more intricacy to an arrangement. Now, what I think is really, really cool is just is the framing. So let's talk about the framing. We just talked about that sort of upsweep, right, on E-flat clarinet, kind of going over a C major seventh chord or C major dominant seventh. And, you know, the first violins sort of doing the same idea, and then the violas doing a harmonic glissando. So we've seen how all of that works, right? And the cellos just kind of continue on with their cha-cha-cha kind of idea. Okay. And the little pizzicato below. Okay. So we know all of that. Now let's look at the sort of coloristic development and the framing. Okay. First thing to notice, you know, before we jump up to all this juicy stuff up here, let's look at the very wonderful background sound that is being taken care of by the double basses. I keep wanting to say contrabasses. Double basses, okay. And Stravinsky shows you right where the node is, right? He's going to want to have this be a harmonic at the major third, right? So if this is a low A, it produces, you know, this very, very high C sharp above, right? So it's just like a good shortcut for touch third harmonics on contrabass is just to assume two octaves above the actual touch third note, right? Rather than the root, right? So, and it's not necessarily the most in tune note either, but that's fine. You know, for Stravinsky's purposes, it doesn't really need to be the most, you know, the most beautifully in tune note. Same thing here. You know, we have the G sharp here and then, you know, played two octaves higher, right there, right? And then of course, this natural D harmonic is very, very easy to play, right? It's just it's just touching the node right in the middle of the D string. Okay, so that goes on, you know, and like, you know, but what is that, right? It is, you know, we've got a D and then a G sharp and then a C sharp above that. And it, you know, it's not necessarily like the most consonant sound, right? Okay, now above that, right, at the other end of the spectrum, we've got this this basically it's just like a C major 6-4 chord, right? You know, so like a second inversion C major chord way up high there, and it's being played also with harmonics. Okay, now, we should be careful about what we say when we mean harmonics on a flute, right? It doesn't really mean that the flute player is doing anything, you know, similar to, you know, like touching nodes and doing things like that. It's more that they are playing the notes using a specific overblowing, okay? Which, I guess is related to the same thing as touching nodes on a string. It's just which node that you touch in order to get what note, right? Okay, so the in this case, the flute player is you know, in terms of like what are these harmonics, they are all third partial harmonics, which, you know, there are some notes that are only possible for on a third partial harmonic, which I believe A is one of those, but you know, for the rest of them, it's really kind of, you know, you sort of need to play other partials to get a stronger sound. But if you force everything to be a third partial harmonic, then, you know, then you end up with just a very like light, airy sound, right? And it's, you know, not the most pleasant sound. It sort of has a way of digging into your ear in a harmony like this, right? And that is exactly what Stravinsky wants. You know, once again, I feel Stravinsky is easily surpassing his master, Rimsky-Korsakov, with scoring like this. And, you know, this is FLAG, period, flageolet. That is basically just saying harmonics, essentially. And, you know, that here, it's kind of the same thing, right? This is intended to be harmonics here with this particular reaction, you know, this chuck-a-chung. And you can hear it just has a very wheezy kind of scraping sound in the, you know, in the overall texture. Okay. Now notice the two muted trumpets have sort of disappeared. And I feel that's because they kind of wouldn't make much of an effect in the particular context of this texture here. Here, where we've got the B-flat clarinets playing octaves of that previous theme that the two muted trumpets played before, and the horn taking the second trumpet part. Now, of course, this is going to be the same notes that were played before, but it's just, you know, transposed up a fifth in F reading, right? And that is being doubled an octave below by the violas in pizzicato. The other violas, altre, you know, played senza sord without mutes, right? So it just really has a wonderful kind of sneaky sound, right? Just almost conspiratorial, right? And once again, music that has been very imitated in cinematic scoring, right? And it basically just goes all the way up to here. Now, this is going to tie over into the next section, and we will see how that all works in a minute. But let's listen to figures 87 through 89 now, and just pay attention to all of those different elements, right? The sweeps up that we already talked about on the previous, in the previous section, the this basic old C major six chord being played in flute harmonics. And, you know, the sort of very sneaky cha-cha-cha, cha-cha-cha kind of idea. And, of course, see if you can hear what's going on here with the double basses being played with their very strange harmony below. All right? Okay? So let's have a listen. Now, the end of this introductory section is coming up really quickly, but I boiled down the last two parts of it into two separate pages that are sort of expanded because there's so little going on. And, yeah, we'll look at both of them now and then listen to them to finish up this month's analysis. So we've still got that C major 6-4 chord kind of just hanging out up there and continuing on now all by itself. You know, you get a whole beat of the flutes playing all by themselves, and it just has the most wonderfully unearthly sound. Now, what is played underneath it? You know, you can really hear the square waves right here, right? So we've got another sort of square wave accompaniment beneath that. So a good chance for the third, fifth, and seventh players to you know, to show their stuff in terms of soloists, right? And they're just playing this little chorale treatment of the main melody, like, hey, remember this? Da 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 da. And notice it ends like a full beat before the end of the flutes, right? So it just sort of hangs over a little bit, and I think that that's just really wonderfully spooky. Turning the page, we see sort of like a response to the reintroduction of the first theme, and that is the second theme responds. And I just love how sort of heavy and almost dismal this whole sound picture is here. So what is going on here? The horns, one and two, soli, are basically playing the melody, and this is right in just the sweet spot range of the horns, right? But played, of course, pianissimo, and sounding down a fifth, right? So, you know, they're just like beautifully kind of mid-range soft sound for the horns, and yet solos, right? You can solo and be pianissimo, right? Okay, and what we've got here is muted cellos and double basses. And what are they doing? It's basically pizzicato and arco on the same notes, right? And they're playing the lower part of this idea, but they're playing it in parallel fifths. And I just really feel it. It just is so somber. It's just like, hey, this is the last night of one of these people's lives, right? And just, we have to really, really respect it. You know, it is just music of just the most utmost seriousness. And the deliciously chocolatey character of this little note here, these two notes on the bass clarinet is just thrilling to me. I mean, so, you know, what is this? This is a low B flat. So it's the same note as this, right? And then it is rising up to a D flat, concert D flat. Right? I'm saying what the non-transposed pitches are. You know, so you've got this D flat this B fifth here, which acts as a ninth, right? At the same time as we've got this G natural here, right? And it just is wonderfully, yeah, just chilling, really. But the way the bass clarinet just is, you know, just calmly plays what it does and adds its little color right into, you know, it's a place where texture, balance, and function work beautifully together, right? Because, you know, there's the functionality of this in terms of, you know, harmony and the feeling of the, you know, the rising feeling of that note as its own little kind of minor little melodic expression. And then you've got the balance of it working perfectly within these particular tones and timbres. And, you know, and then, yeah, and then the whole texture of it just being, you know, just incredibly dark, right? So this is just wonderful, wonderful orchestration. And then, you know, what is the, what is the icing on the cake is just right here, this, you know, this just completely arcane solo cello part comes in. And this is so, like, you know, this was one of the things that the first time I heard it, I feel like I just memorized it for the rest of my life, you know, it's almost nonsensical, like, you know, but it still is, you know, just really gripping, you know, as if the sense of expectation could not get any more devastating. This voice rises, you know, it's almost like a prayer for, you know, what is to happen, right? It's like an announcement, right? A consecration of what is about to happen. And what is about to happen is the beginning of the sacrifice, which is going to, which we're going to analyze. It's not really the sacrifice itself, but the beginning of the ritual that will choose the one who is to be sacrificed. All right, so listen for all of those things. You know, the horns on the previous page as they play underneath the sort of high glowing flutes, and to how, you know, the pizzicato and arco, perfect parallel fifths work here. And then, of course, that just the sound of this wonderful bass clarinet line coming through and the cello that really just ends it in a just, you know, in a thrilling way. Thank you. Thanks, everyone, so much for joining me for this nice long look at Stravinsky's music and writings. Next month on Patreon, I'll have another exclusive interview of a world-class performer with extensive experience performing the Rite of Spring, an excerpt of which I'll share here on the public channel, along with more score analysis of the next section, The Mystic Circle of Adolescence. Happy New Year, everyone, and I'll see you in 2018.